Howdy.
Howdy, writers. My name is Ash, head of Noisy Red Cinema, and as a screenwriter, I think one of my favourite things to do is to kill off characters. We deny our lust for shedding their fictional blood, but you can't deny when you know a particularly gruesome, tragic, or thirst-quenching death scene is coming up in your story. You get excited about it. So in this video, I have got for you 8 great ways to kill off characters. Now, these methods are popular ones that you've likely seen many a time in media, and if you haven't, don't worry, because I'll be giving plenty of examples. Why will I give examples? It's so you can go out and watch them, study them, see whatever work, and try and replicate that in your own projects. But what I want to do is talk about why these methods work, what the benefit of each of these methods is, why some work for certain types of characters and not others, and how to best utilize them in your own work. Because trust me, just using one of these methods isn't a key to success. If you don't know the purpose of the method you're using, you can mess it up. Trust me, a lot of popular writers have. So without further ado, let's begin with part uno. Number one, the sudden death. Now, we all like this one, and I'm starting with this one because it really blends into a lot of the other entries on this list. You can combine the sudden death with most of the other methods below to great effect. But that said, the range with which you can use this method is huge. If you don't know what I'm referring to, think of when you're watching a film, things seem to be going smoothly or otherwise pretty nonchalantly for the characters, and then boom! One of the characters just gets wiped out by a car, or blown up by a random landmine, or just shot in the head. It really knocks you through a loop and takes your breath away just because of how little we saw it coming. It's more often than not this kind of kill that stays in your mind long after you've finished watching whatever it is you're watching. In Game of Thrones, think Tommen leaping from a window to his death. Or in Red Dead Redemption 2, as you walk through an eerily quiet town of Rhodes and poor Sean Maguire is suddenly sniped through the head. Or it can be used to hilarious fashion. In Burn After Reading, Chad nervously grinning ear to ear as he gets caught breaking into Harry's house, only to get quickly and abruptly headshotted, is brilliantly funny. In Four Lions, we're laughing with the guys as we watch Faisal running across a farmer's field, and then we laugh even more when he suddenly trips and blows up. The suddenness of a character going out in a way like this can act as a great punchline. Or horror. Nothing gets the heart pumping like a character just so suddenly being obliterated. Think Death Proof, the car crash that happens in that. Or Final Destination, there's so many to count in that series. There's Terry Chaney, there's Billy Hitchcock, there's our dear old boy David Koechner getting whacked in the head by that wrench. They're all killed out of nowhere. The sudden death gives us variety. And why does it work? Well, like I said before, you remember this one. Being taken from complete peace of mind to sudden shock and surprise, that really sticks with you. It really emotionally envelops you, even if it's not that well done. You know what makes the sudden death work, though? When actually, it's not that sudden. When the audience were given clues it was going to happen, but still, the audience didn't catch it. Because surely the audience thinks things are all safe right now, right? They're not gonna kill anybody right now, right? To further develop on what I'm talking about here, I want to use an example I think most people here will know. An example which is considered one of the greatest moments of television in history. We're going back to Game of Thrones to talk about a Red Wedding. Think about how much the Red Wedding actually was set up, how slowly it all sort of unravels in the moments before it does all kick off and we do lose all of those beloved characters. One by one, the dominoes are falling in that scene, and even then, the deaths hit us as suddenly as Terry Chaney is hit by a bus, as suddenly as Sean has his head blown off. You look back through Game of Thrones and you go, oh my god, this all makes sense. As sudden as it all was, Rob put himself into this position. So really, if we were paying attention, maybe we would have seen it coming. I think it makes it a lot more rewarding. As much as writers and some audiences love shock value, understanding that you can still have shock in a meticulously planned and well-built scene that makes sense for the characters to have found themselves in, both gives the audience that emotional moment and shows that this character didn't just die for pointless shock, but in a moment that was intrinsically set up and paid off for the benefit of the story and for the character. So when you go to kill off a character with the sudden death method, ask yourself why the audience would care to see this character die so abruptly, outside of the initial shock of seeing them die that way. Does it actually work for the character and the decisions they've made? Will the audience feel emotionally gratified or just shortchanged by a senseless and sudden death? kill. Make sure that it makes sense, because when done right, the sudden death is awesome. Now on to number two, the Hope Spot Killer.
Bah! I sounded like Teddy then, from Bob's Burgers.
The Hope Spot Killer is when things look to be going perfectly for our heroes. They've just defeated a minor villain maybe, or found their way out of a really tough situation, and seem to be on the other side of things. We can rejoice, sit back, relax, everyone's safe. Oh, no we aren't, here's another threat and they just killed my favourite character. Why do I ever dare feel happiness? Again, to bring up Game of Thrones, which will come up often on this list, it does the Hope Spot Killer often, that damn cruel show. The Red Wedding fits this because this method goes hand in hand with the sudden death, but he does it again with the Mountain versus the Viper. We think Oberyn has defeated the Mountain, avenged his sister, we're ready to celebrate, and then, oh no, Oberyn, my dear boy, how I loved that head of yours intact. Horror does this often. Think of when you think the main villain's dead, and then they come back and off the final girl just before the end of the film. And perhaps my favourite and most heart-wrenching example is in Breaking Bad, when in season 5, we think Hank, Jesse and Gomi have won, outsmarted Walt at last, only for Uncle Jack to show up, kill Gomi and put a bullet through Hank's head, and in turn, from my dear old heart. You can only do this one so many times because again it's very cruel. If you overdo it, you'll actually turn people off of your piece because they'll just be too emotionally defeated and detached, because it really is putting your audience through the ringer. But that said, when it's done well, gosh, is it a great strategy for pulling your audience's heartstrings. If your heroes always win, this is a good way of cementing a new threat, saying that, hey, this time it's going to be a bit more difficult. So it's great when you really want to escalate the drama and tension. It's also good if you really want to make an audience hate an antagonist. Nothing causes hatred for a villain more than when not only do they ruin a happy moment for the heroes, but they do so by killing off an audience favourite. This one works so well because you've led your audience into a false sense of security, got them to turn their back, so it's so much easier to stick that knife into it. You've really tackled your audience when they least expect it, and trust me, if you do it well, when that initial shock wears off, they'll look back and thank you for it. Now number three, the heartbreaking news. This sort of borrows from the previous two entries. It works because of the suddenness of a revelation and because of how out of nowhere it can come during an otherwise quite upbeat moment in the story. It's when a character is delivered news of another character's death, and it's news for the audience too. The delivery of this news is often sharp, blunt, and depending who's delivering it, nasty. Whether the character is told by a loved one or by the killer themselves, like the character, the audience are probably shocked by it. Think at the end of 7. What's in the box? Oh, it's just your wife's head, Mills. Sorry. In Harry Potter, the news that Mad-Eye Moody was shot out of the sky hits us like a ton of bricks. The show community hits us with this twice. First with Starburns, although that turns out to not be true, and then much harder later on when Shirley breaks the news to Jeff, Annie, and ourselves that Pierce has passed away. But to me, never does it hit harder than it does in Bridge to Terabithia. I think that book was written to ruin your life. The bluntness with which the news is delivered,
your friend Leslie's dead,
just sends a shock all the way up your spine. We adored Leslie, and we are right there with Jesse as we feel a grief at hearing that she's gone. I think that's why this works so much, the relatability. Unlike the characters in fiction, it's very rare we actually watch our loved ones go out in violent fashion, but what we can relate to is being sat down by a family member and told delicately that someone from our life is gone. And I think that's why in Bridge to Terabithia, a story about these two kids who become best friends and live out their lives in this beautiful and fascinating world created by their own imagination, it so gut-wrenchingly opposes all of that when he breaks the news that Leslie's dead. We're just told point blank by Jesse's family in Jesse's living room, and we feel that grief with him because we felt that moment in our own lives. So for this one, it's great to use in more down-to-earth stories. If you want to create a connection between your audience and the characters, there's nothing better than them going through grief together. I am aware that as this video goes on, by the way, it is getting darker and darker in this room. There's not much I can do about that, apologies. But enough about the lighting, on to number 4, The sacrifice. My, a heartstrings yanked at when a character is willing to give their own life to save the lives of others. We've seen it plenty, but it so often works because no bigger thing can be given to show your love for someone else than your life for theirs. So when and why does the sacrifice work? Well, for two types of characters, I would say. The first is the lovable, heroic fan favourites. Maybe they do have to die, the story just calls for it, but reward the audience with their death. Don't just constantly have characters pointlessly polished off. Have this hero go out saving the lives of others, or overcoming some greater evil. That way, even though they're gone, their death will feel poignant, meaningful, and the audience will be able to accept their loss much better. And whatever you do, don't undo it by bringing the villain back that they sacrifice themselves to defeat. That is always awful. In Avengers Endgame, Tony Stark sacrifices himself to take out Thanos. In The Exorcist, Father Karras does this to save Reagan from Pazuzu. In perhaps one of the most heartbreaking examples put to film, we have Inside Out, where to rescue Joy, Bing Bong sacrifices his own entire existence to the memory dump. That last line he says before he goes, I can't repeat or I will genuinely cry.
Take her to the moon for me, okay?
And the second type of character to do this with is the character at the end of their redemption arc. If a character isn't surviving the story, it's a perfect way to see them go out. No better way encapsulates them going from villain to hero or cowardly to brave than the act of giving up their own life so the heroes can live or succeed. Maybe they're just too evil and have just done too much bad for them to really deserve to live, but at least they can go out doing one last act of good. Think in Aliens when Hudson, after spending most of the film being a crybaby, gives a defiant last stand seeing him get slaughtered by xenomorphs. Or in Bloodfest when the miserable and cowardly Hinckley kills himself in a jigsaw-like horror trap so he can save the girlfriend of a young protagonist he's come to adore. In Lord of the Rings we have Boromir, who goes out riddled with arrows, saving the very hobbits he previously saw as a threat to his own corrupted desire to hold the One Ring. The sacrifice is an emotional but truly meaningful way to take out one of your main characters, so consider doing it for your story, but make sure it's a character who really truly deserves to go out this way. Side character Pete, who's had 3 lines and has been around for maybe less than 10 minutes, does not deserve to go out in such overly poetic fashion. So that concludes part 1 of this video. I don't want to drone on for too long in just one video, so I thought I'd make a part 2 where I can cover the next 4 methods on this list in a bit more detail. If you enjoyed this one guys, please remember to like, subscribe, hit the notification bell, and follow our socials. Are there any types of death in fiction that you especially like? Well if so, let me know in the comments. But until then guys, keep your eyes peeled, I'll see you in part 2. Stay positive!